Topic about classical field theory that I wanted to cover in order to introduce to you then quantum field theory. Of course, it's not the last topic in classical field theory that in principle you need to know, because as you saw, we almost never discuss about interactions in classical field theory. We focused mostly on the solution of a free equation, where the equation of motion are at most linear in the field, and with only one field. And we didn't say much about the case where you have interactions, you have more fields at the same time, or higher powers of the field in the equation of motion. And this is because those cases, in principle, the general solution is not known. You cannot apply the trick we saw before the previous days about Fourier transform, because if you have more powers of the field and you perform a Fourier transform, you don't get just an algebraic equation between the Fourier modes, but you'll find equally complicated equations also in Fourier space. And indeed, yeah, as I just mentioned, the general equation to a generic field theory with interaction is not known. In some cases, there are known some specific solutions. And in general, so these kind of problems are either solved or approximated using what is called perturbation theory. If some of the parameters describing the interaction are small, you can perform an expansion in the small parameter, and then you can see that you can compute in perturbation theory the solutions. And this is we will discuss this in the second part of the course when we'll discuss interactions. Or you have to just integrate the differential equation numerically with the computer also. Okay, so now going back to the topic instead I wanted to discuss today, which is the last one, is about symmetries and conserved currents. So you remember that we already discussed a symmetry of our field theory, of the classical field theory, which is actually the symmetry where we constructed relativistic quantum field theory, which is Poincaré invariant. And we constructed the Lagrangian in such a way that the action was invariant. So we now go through again the discussion of symmetries, more in general than just Poincaré symmetry, and the implication of having a symmetry in your Lagrangian, in your theory, which is basically related to Noether theorem, and you already saw more in general in a specific example of a mechanical system with a finite number of degrees of freedom. So I'm going to start discussing what are called internal symmetries, which are symmetries of the fields that do not affect space-time. So they are all the symmetries which are not Poincaré symmetry. And so they act on what are called internal spaces. So what they do basically is just mix or transform the field itself between themselves. So, as usual, a symmetry is a transformation of the field that basically maps a solution to the equation of motion into solution of the equation of motion, analogously to Poincaré invariance. And so they basically represent invariances of the laws of nature under those transformations. So if the symmetry is associated to a continuum parameter, and when the continuum parameter is sent to zero, you recover the identity, so the transformation doesn't act trivially, then one can show that there's always a conserved current associated to the symmetry. And there will be a conserved current and charge for each symmetry you have in the Lagrangian. So if you have a symmetry with more independent parameters, you will have one such current, conserved current, for each parameters, independent parameters of the symmetry. So now we are going to see how this is is about in classical field theory. So let's imagine you have a field, actually can have n fields, phi r of x, and this index r represents here either a label that labels different fields, phi 1, phi 2, phi 3, or it can even label a Lorentz index, for example, a mu index. So this R can represent the various components of some Lorentz multiplet. So I want to be generic, I just put an index R that counts basically all the fields and all the components of the fields, of the theory. And I'm going to consider a transformation which maps a field, phi r of x, in a transformed field, phi prime r of x, and this transformation is related to this one through, let's say, a continuous parameter alpha, so that when alpha goes to zero, the transformation basically maps to the identity. So for infinitesimal transformations, when alpha parameter is very small, so there is an alpha parameter here, the transformed field will have automatically the form phi r of x plus something proportional to alpha itself, which I call delta phi r. So in general, the transformed field will be a parameter of alpha, I don't know, let me write it here. And when I consider alpha very small, for very small alpha, I can expand in alpha, and then I get the field I started with, for alpha equal to zero, which corresponds to making no transformation, plus something proportional to alpha, plus order, higher order terms in alpha. Whatever multiply alpha in this transformation, I call delta phi r, and this is basically what determines the transformation. So if you already saw the groups, it means that basically when alpha is small, this is associated to the algebra of the group. So, as we did for the Poincaré symmetry, now if this transformation is a symmetry, a necessary, a sufficient condition for this to be the case is that the action S of the theory is left invariant under transformation alpha. Okay? If this is the case, the action is invariant, it means that the equation of motion maps basically find solutions that are mapped into solution by this transformation. So basically, S in general goes to under transformation alpha goes into S prime, and I require that the action is invariant, which basically means that in other words, ds in d alpha is equal to zero if I transform S by alpha. Any questions so far? I just repeated the same logic that we already employed for Poincaré. Okay. So if this is the case, the action is invariant, it means that the Lagrangian density, remember the action and the Lagrangian density are related by an integral. If this is the case, then under this transformation of the field, the Lagrangian can transform up to a course, if the Lagrangian is invariant, so this is zero, the action is automatically invariant. But this is, in general, this is too strong a constraint. We can also allow the Lagrangian not to be invariant, but to transform in such a way that the transformation is proportional to a total derivative, a d mu of some vector field k mu of x. Because then this variation, if I put it inside the action, the integral of the 4x of the total derivative is zero, and the action stays invariant. In other words, total derivatives do not contribute to the equation of motion. So if this is the case, then this is the constraint I'm going to require for my symmetry. Okay? Okay, so this must be true for any of these transformations that I call symmetry. And now I'm going to rewrite this in a different way. First, I'm going to basically try to evaluate explicitly the left-hand side of this equation. So remember that the Lagrangian, in general, is a function of the fields phi r and their derivative, d mu phi r. So if I take the derivative of the Lagrangian respect to alpha, so I transform the arguments of the Lagrangian density according to this transformation, the n in the alpha of this is what? Well, I can first derive with respect to the first argument, which is d Lagrangian density with respect to phi r times d phi r in the alpha, but d phi r in the alpha is just delta phi r. Plus the derivative of the Lagrangian density with respect to the second argument, which is dl in du phi r, times the variation of d mu phi r with respect to alpha, which is given by here, d mu delta phi r. So, if this is a symmetry, this object here, for a clever choice of delta phi r, must be equal to a total derivative, d mu k mu. This must be true when I transform the field around any configuration of the field phi r. Okay? Because this is the definition of a symmetry. However, now I'm going to impose the equation of motion. So instead of transforming the field phi around a generic field configuration, for which this is true by construction, I'm going to do this around a particular field configuration, which is solution of the equation of motion. So you remember that the equation of motion implies that delta L in d phi r is also equal to dl in d mu phi r d mu. Sorry, I wrote it. Okay? So if I use the equation of motion now. On the equation of motion, I can replace, for example, this term here, which is the same as here, with this derivative here. So the equation above becomes d mu of dl in d d mu phi r, which is the first term, times delta phi r. Plus dl in d mu phi r times d mu delta phi r equal d mu k mu. Now you see, however, that these two terms can be combined into a total derivative, because here d mu of the first term delta phi r, the first term d mu delta phi r. So these two terms can be combined into d mu of dl in d mu phi r times delta phi r. And then I'm going to bring this object here on the left hand side and put also k mu inside the derivative. And I finally get this relation here. So I find that d mu of this object, which is a vector field, is equal to zero. I'm going to rewrite this here. I find that if I define j mu as what is inside here, which means dl in d mu phi r delta phi r minus k mu. Then d mu j mu is equal to zero. So if you have a symmetry, that is, if under this type of transformation, a continuum symmetry parameterized by this parameter alpha, under this transformation, the action is invariant, which means that the Lagrangian is invariant up to a total derivative. On the equation of motion, this implies that this particular combination, this vector field, which is related to the transformation, the Lagrangian, and the way the Lagrangian transforms, it's a conserved current, which means d mu j mu is equal to zero. And this is the so-called Noether theorem, in classical field theory. Any questions? So the presence of a conserved current means that you can define also a conserved charge, and I think this you already saw in other courses, but I'm going to going to consider a four volume omega. So imagine this is time and this is space. So this is space here and this is time here. Let's take a box of a four volume and let's integrate the mu g mu over this four volume. So let me integrate over a four volume omega d mu g mu, and since d mu g mu is identical to zero, also its integral will be zero. But this is also equal, so I'm now going to write the single components explicitly. So this is equal to the integral in dt between t1 and t2. We say that this is t1 and this is t2. Of d0 j0. D0 is, I can bring it out from the integral in d3x, and I write integral in d0, integral in d3x, sorry, derivative with respect to time, the integral in d3x of j0. And then, plus, I have di ji here. So this is again the integral in t between t1 and t2. And then I have the integral in d3x, still inside the box, of di ji, but di ji is nothing else than the divergence of the three current j, the special part of the four current. Now I'm going to define Q as the integral in d3x of the zero component of the current, J0, which is basically this object here. And now you see that this is a total derivative in d0, so the integral dt of d0 of q is nothing else than the values of q, the difference of the values of q between the extrema. So q at t2 minus q at t1, where q is defined as this. Plus, now this is the integral in dt between t1 and t2, and this is the integral in d3x, so this is the integral over, at some point in time, is the integral over a slice of space inside this box of a divergence, but you can use Stokes' theorem, the volume integral of a divergence is just the flux of the current on the boundaries of the box. So this is the integral over the boundaries of the box of the sigma dot j, which is the flux of the three current on the boundaries. And this must be equal to zero, which means that basically the variation of the charge between T1 and T2 is basically given by the integrated flux of current that goes out from the box. So this is the analogous conservation of current in electromagnetism. So the charge inside the box is conserved unless you have some current flows from the box, and the variation of the charge is related to the variation of the flux, to the integral of the flux. In the special case where you send the box boundaries to infinity, which means that you integrate over all V3x in such a way that there is no boundary, or if you want, if there is no flux of charge going to spatial infinity, then this part, this term is zero, and the charge is indeed conserved. So Q of T is equal to a constant if the phi is zero. So in particular, if you just assume that all the field goes to zero at infinity, so there is no charge flow, and integrate over all space, the total charge is a constant of motion. Q dot is equal to 3. Any questions?
Professor?
Yes.
Sorry, I lost you at the point where you integrated Q over the time part.
Which line? This line or this line?
As you move from the previous one to the one you're handling right now.
Between these two. So I define the charge as the integral in V3x of J naught. This is just the definition. Okay? And then I perform this integral here. This is the integral of a total derivative. So the integral is just the difference of the value of Q between T2 and T1. Okay? The second term, instead, comes from basically the spatial components di, ji. I just wrote explicitly dt and d3x, and then di, ji is nothing else than the divergence of the three current, right? Di, by definition, of divergence. And now for this step here, I use Stokes' theorem that says that if you have an integral of a divergence, a volume integral of a divergence, this is also equal to the flux, the outgoing flux of the current along the boundaries of the box. And then you integrate over T1 over time between T1 and T2. So this is basically the integrated flux that goes through the boundaries. And since the whole combination is zero, can bring on the other side and can see that the variation of the charge defined in that way between two times matches the integral of the flux from the current. Okay. Any other question? No? Okay. Then I'm going now to show some example where we compute explicitly the conserved current and charges. Charge, which is the integral in dpx of j naught. Okay. So this I keep for all the examples. So the first example I'm going to discuss is the Lagrangian of a complex scalar field, the one we already wrote the Lagrangian of a few lectures ago. In particular, I'm going to consider the Lagrangian, which is d mu phi modulo square minus, now I'm going to consider also interactions. At this level, it doesn't matter. All the discussion I made before holds for a generic field theory, with all the interactions, not just for field theories. So I'm going to write the potential here, v of modulus of phi square. So V is just a function of the modulus of phi. Remember, phi is complex, so phi is not equal to phi star. The Lagrangian needs to be real in order for the Hamiltonian to be real and energy to be real. And here, so I'm just considering a function of the modulus of phi, which are automatically real. So if I consider this Lagrangian here for a generic potential V, I can see that there is a symmetry, which is a continuous transformation of the field, which keep the action invariant. And such a symmetry is, anybody wants to guess? It's free to talk.
Phase,
yes. I can make the following transformation. Phi goes into phi prime, which is just a phase transformation. E to the I alpha, my continuous parameter. Let's put also a multiplicative factor Q here, times phi. So if I perform a generic transformation of this kind, you can see that phi modulo square is automatically invariant, and also d mu phi, since this is a constant, modulo square is automatically invariant. So indeed, this is a transformation that keeps the Lagrangian invariant, so not only the action, but also the Lagrangian is invariant, which means that this k mu in this particular case is zero. Okay, then I had to extract delta phi r. Delta phi r I extract from the transformation property when I expand in small alpha. So let me expand in small alpha the transformation. So this becomes phi itself plus I alpha Q phi itself. So from comparing these two terms here, I can read what delta phi is. Delta phi is whatever multiply alpha, right, in the transformation. So delta phi is I Q phi. Okay? So now I can just replace the expression delta phi and k into the definition of the current j. So in this case, j mu is equal. So dl in d mu phi r, or maybe should notice first that you remember that phi and phi star are two different fields, right? So I have to treat them independently. So this r index now, it's basically summing over all fields, so both phi and phi star. So maybe I'll write explicitly here, although it's trivial, also the transformation property of phi star. So of course phi star transforms with the opposite phase, because it's just the complex conjugate of phi itself. So we'll have a minus sign here, so delta phi star is nothing else but minus I q phi star. Okay, so now I can write j mu explicitly. I start with phi, so I have the derivative of the Lagrangian density with respect to d mu phi. Here there is d mu phi, d mu phi star. So if I derive with respect to d mu phi, I will be left with d mu phi star. And then I have to multiply delta phi r, the transformation of the field phi, which is I q phi. To the first field phi. Here I have to do it for all the fields, so I have to add also the transformation from the second field phi star. So for phi star now I derive with respect to d mu phi star. D mu phi star multiply d mu phi. So from that derivative I get d mu phi. And then I have to multiply by delta phi r star. Delta phi star is just minus I q phi star. So here I have minus I q phi star. And finally I have to subtract k mu, but in this particular case k mu is zero. So that's it. That's the final expression for our current. So let me write, I can take IQ outside and write this as, let me write it like this, in a little bit fancy way. So this symbol here, d mu with a double arrow, means that I take the derivative of phi and then minus the derivative of what is on the left of the derivative, right? So, okay, so if I have a d mu double arrow b, this is defined as a d mu b minus d mu a. This is just a definition of the symbol that you might encounter in the literature, so I'm just defining it in this way. And you can write the expression of the current in a more compact way. Okay? Okay, so this is the conserved current, d mu. And I leave you as an exercise to check that indeed, if you take this and compute d mu, j mu, you find zero. And it's not a completely trivial exercise, okay? So please try. Just to complete, then let me write explicitly also the charge, capital Q, which is equal to the integral v3x of the zero component of j nu. So I have minus I Q, put it outside, and then here you have a phi star phi dot minus phi star dot phi. I have only time derivatives. And if you integrate over all the 3x, provided that the fields go to zero at infinity in such a way that the integral is convergent, this object is constant in time. And you can also check if this is the case. So you can also, as an exercise, check that. Starting from this expression, compute Q dot, where the integrand is performed over all space, you'll find that Q dot is equal to zero. Of course, if it's a current is conserved, so the mu j mu is equal to zero, they are right here. If you multiply the current by any constant, you will still be conserved. This is a triviality. This means that the proportionality factor of also the sign of the current is a convention. Things will be a little bit different when we consider interactions, because that typically fixes a preferred normalization of the charge and the current, which is basically the one associated to the charge you can actually measure in the laboratory. Any questions about this example? How to use the formula to derive the current? All clear?
One question. In this case, we consider only phase that leaves the Lagrangian invariant. Can we find a symmetry that leaves the action invariant than the Lagrangian?
Very good question. Yes. We will discuss a couple of examples where indeed this k mu is different from zero. First, however, I will give another example where k is equal to zero. Okay. Any other questions? All right, then I will erase and show another example. So the other example instead has to do with more fields, but real. So let me consider n real scalar fields. So n fields, let's say phi I goes from 1 to capital N, and they are real. So equal to 5i star. And the Lagrangian I'm going to consider is 1/2 the new phi I the new phi I sum over I and minus 1/2 m squared sum over I phi I squared. Okay, I consider quadratic Lagrangian, but you can actually, in fact, let me consider, like before, let me consider a generic function of sum of I phi I squared. The sum, of course, is taken from 1 to n. Okay, so who knows what's the symmetry of this Lagrangian? Any clues? Yes. You can rotate these fields among themselves. So you can perform a transformation, an orthogonal transformation in n dimensions. N is the number of fields. So the theory is invariant under On transformations. So phi I will transform into phi I prime, which is related to phi I through a rotation R I J phi J. R I J is a rotation, which means that it's a matrix, right, which satisfies R transpose R equal to the identity. So that when you transform each of these terms here, you get R acting on phi, R acting on phi, but then they are, the indices are saturated, always the first index with the first index, so you get R transpose R, which is equal to the identity, so the kinetic term, the derivative term is invariant, and each of these terms is invariant because phi I squared is just a scalar product, right, of the phi, so it's invariant on the orthogonal rotations. So remember that the rotation R can also be written as e to the alpha capital A Ta. Ta is the generator of rotations in n dimensions, so these are just the basis of anti-symmetric matrices in n by n space. And alpha A are free parameters, real parameters, and you have one for each generator of rotations. So if you have n fields, n is in the fundamental of On, how many generators A you have? Question?
Like n times n minus 1 over 2.
Exactly. So you have n times n minus 1 over 2 generators. So this capital A index go from 1 to n times n minus 1 over 2. which means that you have n times n minus 1 over 2 real parameters associated to independent transformation. So in this case, then you expect to have n times n minus 1 over 2 conserved charges and conserved currents. So let's construct them. So as usual, here we just have to identify each term that appears in Gmu. So first of all, K mu is equal to zero also in this case, since we just checked that the Lagrangian density is invariant by itself. Then we have to instruct delta phi r. So we have to expand basically the generic transformation, the generic rotation, into infinitesimal transformation. So let me write here, this is also equal, if you expand, to phi I plus, then you expand just exponent, so you get alpha A T A I J phi J. So repeated indices are summed over, so I'm not writing explicitly the sum over I here, also into there, okay? And same also for this capital A index. So the small I, j indices go from 1 to n, the capital A indices go from 1 to n, n minus 1 over 2. So A is in the adjoint, and I, j are in the fundamental. Okay, so you see here there are n times n minus 1 over 2 independent parameter and independent transformation. So from here I read that delta phi A, so the transformation associated to the A parameter, alpha A parameter, is I, delta I phi I is T A I J phi J. Just multiply alpha A. So now I can write directly J mu. J mu will have an index A because I have one current for each symmetry parameter. Here you have the derivative of the Lagrangian density with respect to d mu phi r, which in this case is phi I. So I derive with respect to d mu phi I. Here I have two terms, so I get the factor of 2, which simplifies the 1 half. I'm left with d mu phi I. So d mu phi I from the first factor. And this multiplies delta phi r, which means delta phi a here, which is this factor here, t a I j phi j. So both I and J indices are summed over, while capital A is not, is the same index that appears here. And that's it, because K mu is zero and I already summed over all things. So that is the expression for the current, and there are n times n minus 1 over 2 independent currents, so independent conserved currents. And again, you can check that indeed the region U A is 0 for any A. conserve charge is just the integral in d3x of the zero component, and the zero component is just phi dot I T A I J. So this is charge QA. There are again n minus 1 over 2 of them. Phi J. And again, if you integrate over d3x over the whole space, it is just that indeed the Q dot is equal to 0. Questions? Notice that the previous example is a special case of this example. Because if you remember, the phase transformation is a U1 transformation, but the U1 transformation is isomorphic to SO2, so to the n equal to 2 case. And in fact, if you rewrite the complex field phi, phi star, in terms of phi 1 plus I phi 2, and phi 1 minus I phi 2, it will basically be written in terms of phi 1 and phi 2 into a Lagrangian of this form. So in that case, and in fact you can check that in that case the currents and the charges are the same or proportional to each other. And here you can see immediately that the generators are antisymmetric. So actually this index here is antisymmetrized, I and J. So this derivative here, you can also rewrite as the derivative on this minus the derivative on that. So you reconstruct exactly the same form of the current and charges as we saw before. So you can just perform the explicit field redefinition in terms of phi 1 and phi 2 and check that indeed the expressions are the same up to an overall constant. Okay? Questions? Okay, then I will move on to the next two examples, which we rapidly saw, but we didn't discuss about the Mendel theorem for them, and are basically the generators of the Poincaré group itself. So the first transformation now of the Poincaré group that I'm going to discuss are the space and time translations. So remember, those are transformations that map a field phi r of x into phi r of x prime, which is actually given by phi r of x minus xi. Xi is a constant, which is the translation either in space or in time. So there are four of those parameters, xi mu, one associated to the translation in time, and the other three, the translation in space. So we have four independent parameters for translations, so we expect to have four independent conserved currents and conserved charges. So now we're going to construct those, just applying the same rule that we saw in general. Okay, so first of all, let's write the transformation of the field. expanding over the small parameter. Here alpha is played by xi mu. So I'm going to expand around the small xi mu. But you see this corresponds to Taylor expand the field around x. So this is also equal to phi r of x minus psi mu d mu phi r of x. Okay? I might want to actually change the index into nu. Okay? So our delta phi r, I will have a 4 delta phi r, one for each of the component of xi, which are the four independent transformation. Maybe I'm going to write it, let's see here. So I have the delta phi r associated to the transformation xi nu. So this will have a index nu here. Will be minus whatever multiply the component xi nu, which is minus d nu phi r. Okay. Now I notice, however, that the Lagrangian is not invariant. The Lagrangian by construction transforms as a scalar field. As a scalar field, transform non-trivially under space-time translation. So, since the Lagrangian is a scalar field, it transforms analogously into L of x minus xi. So, for infinitesimal transformation, this transforms into L of x minus xi nu d nu L, like any other field. So since I want index mu here, let me write this also as let's see. So I rewrote it as with the Kronecker delta, delta mu, nu, L, d mu, which was basically this is d nu, L. Okay? So in this way, now I see that the Lagrangian is invariant up to a total derivative. And from the total derivative, I read my coefficient scale mu, my field scale mu. The L in D alpha in this case will be the L in D xi nu, and these are given by minus delta mu nu L. So in this case, scale mu, for we also have an index nu because I have four of this transformation, will be given by minus delta mu nu Lagrangian. Is it clear? If not, I can repeat. Okay.
How do you write the Kronecker delta there?
This Kronecker delta?
Mm-hmm.
I just rewrote this term here as this term here, because you see Kronecker delta just say that mu index is equal to nu index, so this becomes d nu L. Okay?
Thank you.
I wrote it in this way because I wanted to write as a d mu of some k mu with a mu index, because then the mu index will be the index of the four current. Instead, the nu index is the index of the parameter of the transformation. So I want to distinguish these two indices. So I introduce this connector. Okay, so if there are no other questions, then we are basically done, because we have all the ingredients, delta phi, k, and then we are there in the d mu phi to construct the conserved current. So I'm going to write the conserved currents start here as J mu. So we said that there are four independent transformations, Xi nu. So we'll have four independent currents. So I have a J mu for each of these parameters, Xi nu. So I have a J mu for each nu. Okay? I have four currents, J mu, one for each of the parameters J mu, nu. And the expression is basically given by here. So I have the derivative of the Lagrangian with respect to d mu phi r. D mu phi r. And I have to multiply this by delta phi r, which is minus d mu phi r. Subtract k mu. So I'm going to add delta mu mu times the Lagrangian delta. And basically that's it. So by conventions, usually let me now introduce a different object, which I'm going to write here. So I'm going to erase this a little bit more. I'm going to write this as capital T mu mu. And I'm going to define this object as minus j mu with the raise index nu. So I'm going to raise this index nu with a metric. And then I multiply everything by minus. And this means that the first term becomes dn in d mu phi r, indeed d mu phi r, times d cut with the upper nu phi r, minus, now delta mu nu becomes the metric g mu nu, times the Lagrangian delta. So, of course, the two objects are related to each other just by an overall constant, minus one, and just erase the index. So if this object is conserved, also this object is conserved, in particular, d mu, t mu nu is equal to 0. So you see that there are four conserved currents, one for each value of the nu index, and they are conserved, the nu, t mu, nu is equal to 0. Which is, let's say, come from the mu, g mu, nu equal to 0. This object here is called also stress energy tensor, and are basically associated to the four conserved charges or currents of space and time translations, which I'm sure you are very familiar with already. But to write it in a more manifest way, let's write now explicitly the conserved charges, which are the integral in d3x of the zero component of the current. So, which means the current will be the integral in d3x of the zero component of each of these current, t0 nu, without much imagination, I'm going to call this object P nu. And explicitly, this is the integral in d3x. And then I have to take the zero component of this expression. Zero component means mu equal to 0. So this is dl in d phi dot. But dl in d phi dot is what we call pi. R is the conjugate momentum of the field phi r, so it's pi r times d nu of phi r, this we keep, minus g zero nu de Lagrangian density. So now if you take the first charge, P0, and you just substitute nu equal to 0, now you see you recover d3x pi r phi dot r minus g00, which is 1, the Lagrangian density. But this is nothing else than the Hamiltonian. So indeed, the conserved charge associated to the invariance of time translation is the energy and is the Hamiltonian of the system, as it should. Instead, the conserved charge is associated to space translation invariance, are the special component of this tensor, so it's the integral in d3x of pi r. Now I take the special component di phi r, and since I erase the index, this is should be written as a minus grad I phi r, and g 0 I is 0 because the metric is diagonal, so that's it. So this object here is basically defines what the spatial momentum, the conserved spatial momentum of a field is. So if you have a field configuration and you substitute phi and pi, or phi dot, for example, for a canonical scalar field. Inside this integral, you take the integral, that will give you the total momentum of the field configuration, which is automatically conserved as a result of space translation invariance. integrand of the Hamiltonian, right? We call it Hamiltonian density. And you can analogously define some curly pi as the momentum density of the field. It tells you what is the density of three momentum of the field. Of course, that itself is not conserved because you can transfer three momentum from one part to the other part of the field. What is conserved is its integral. And so from here you also see one of the claims made at the beginning of the course, the fact that the Hamiltonian is not an invariant. In fact, the Hamiltonian is the zero component of a four vector. And analogously, the Hamiltonian density is not a scalar field. In fact, the Hamiltonian density is associated to P00, which is the 0,0 component of a tensor field. So it's not, it doesn't transform as a scalar field, it transforms as a 0,0 component of a tensor field. So under Lorentz transformation, it will mix with all the other components of the energy momentum tensor. Questions?
Yes.
Sorry, say it again. Can you speak a little bit louder?
Yeah, I mean the energy momentum tensor we have there, it's in you.
Yes.
So having both indices up or having one up and one down doesn't make any difference?
Well, you can bring up and down indices with a metric. One thing you have to be careful is that with this definition of the energy momentum tensor, this definition is not, it provides a tensor, T mu nu, which is not symmetric. So you have to be careful with the orders of indices. In particular, while D mu T mu nu is zero, this is not the case if I do D mu T mu nu. Okay? There is a different definition of T mu nu, which is symmetric, and for which then you can exchange also the order of the mu and nu indices. But this will be part of an exercise. So with this definition of T mu nu, which basically is this one, the currents are associated to the second index, the four currents, each current is J mu with respect to the first index. Okay? Did I answer a question?
Yes.
Okay. Any other questions? Okay, so these are the conserved quantities, energy and three momentum associated to the four translations of the Poincaré group. And indeed, they represent for generic field configuration, they represent the energy and the three momentum. So for example, you might be familiar in electromagnetism, the energy is associated to the energy of the electric and magnetic field, E squared plus B squared. The momentum is basically, you already saw it, it's like the pointing vector, which is basically encodes the momentum transfers by electromagnetic waves. All right, so there are no other questions. I will rapidly go through the last example to discuss, which is now associated to the conservation of charges and current associated to the Lorentz group itself. So the Lorentz group has six generators. So in general, it will be six conserved currents and six conserved charges associated to Lorentz transformations. And now we're going to see what are these currents. Okay? So first, again, you have to recover what delta phi and k are, and then you just substitute like we did before and get the expression. So let's take a generic field phi r of x, and now we perform a Lorentz transformation. So phi r will transform into a new field phi prime r of x. And now this, if we want to be generic, we have to allow for phi to transform also non-trivially under Lorentz. So we're not only considering scalar field, we're also considering other representation of the Lorentz group. So in general, we can write that phi r prime of x is some matrix S rs, function of lambda, the Lorentz transformation, phi s of lambda minus 1 x of the field. So remember, the field transforms under Lorentz transformation by, in this way, phi of lambda, one, lambda to the minus 1 of x, we saw it, right? And in general, it transforms if he has some Lorentz index in front, and will transform as some representation of the Lorentz group. If it's a scalar field, this s is trivial, 1. Phi transforms as a vector, this matrix S of lambda will be lambda itself, or lambda to the minus 1, if it's a covariant controvariant vector. If it's a spinor, it will transform like E to the sigma, where sigma is made of gamma matrices. You might have seen this in the relativistic quantum mechanics, and so on. If it's a tensor, it will transform like a product of lambdas and so on. So S, for us, is just a generic representation of the Lorentz group, okay, associated to this field. So lambda can be written, the Lorentz transformation can be written as in terms of epsilon, where epsilons are the six parameters of the Lorentz transformation. So lambda, say mu nu, is associated to e to the epsilon nu nu, and epsilon mu nu is an antisymmetric tensor, which indeed parameterizes the six generators of the Lorentz group, or the six parameters. So the ij components would be the three rotation, and the zero I components would be the boosts. And e to the f would be a matrix, and in general, this is the generic transformation. And analogously, S rs for lambda, I can write it by expanding it. So if I expand this for small variation, epsilon, lambda will be equal to the identity delta plus epsilon itself. I just expand this in terms of matrices. And S will also be, in general, I can write it as the identity delta rest proportional to the generator, to the parameter of the self-formation, epsilon mu mu times a matrix sigma mu mu rs. So epsilon mu mu, again, right, is an antisymmetric tensor, are the six components, the six parameters of the Lorentz transformation, and sigma mu mu rs represent basically the generators of the Lorentz group in the representation relevant for the field phi. So mu nu indices are the basically six components of the generator, the six generators, and RS run over the representation, the dimensionality of the representation of phi. Let me define it with the factor 1/2 in front. So S basically in matrix form, this is expanding in epsilon. If you don't expand, this is the form of E to the 1/2 epsilon sigma with implicit indices. Okay? So now we have to expand lambdas and S in terms of epsilon at leading order in epsilon. So let's do it. Yeah. So phi prime of x, we can write it as, so let me write first s expanded, which is delta rs plus 1/2 epsilon mu mu. So I wrote it mu mu sigma mu mu rs. Expanded this, and then I have to expand this. So remember that lambda minus 1 is just delta minus epsilon, and if I expand in epsilon, this again corresponds to just take the Taylor expansion, right, of phi around x. So this gives phi s of x minus epsilon now the index is rho sigma is the transformed argument at leading order in x, and then I expand in epsilon. This is like a Taylor expansion around x. So this is also equal to phi s of x minus epsilon rho sigma x sigma times d rho. So if I expand in epsilon, I can either take this term or this term. The cross product is higher order in epsilon. So I put it together. So I can write this as delta rs phi s, which is phi r. Then I have this term here, which is 1/2 epsilon mu mu sigma mu mu rs phi s. now, since this doesn't multiply this, I can use mu new indices here instead of rho s. So this is also equal to minus epsilon mu nu x nu d nu phi r. Now, it is convenient to lower this index and raise this one. And now you see that epsilon mu nu is anti-symmetric. So this selects only the anti-symmetric combination of this tensor here. So here I can take the anti-symmetric part with a factor of 1/2, because the second part here, which I added, is the same as this once contracted with the anti-symmetric tensor here. So I put a 1/2 here. So you see that we have six parameters, epsilon mu nu, all the transformations. We will have six currents. So the six parameters is like we have six alphas, okay?
When you did a stacked expansion, you ignored the term of epsilon squared because it's linear, no? Because we always do that, no?
Yeah, we are expanding in alpha, right? And we stop at the first order in alpha.
Okay, thank you.
This is the way we found the current. All right, so. Okay, so now let me write explicitly here. We found that delta phi is the coefficient of epsilon mu nu, which is the coefficient of alpha of the transformation. So it's one half, it's this expression here, which is 1/2 sigma mu nu r s phi s. Here, and then I add minus, so I write plus that term here first, so it's plus x mu b mu phi r minus x nu b mu phi r. If you want, this is the delta mu nu, these are the six parameters of the transformation, the six delta phi's associated to the six generators of the Lorentz group. Okay? So this is the first ingredient. And then the second ingredient is k mu. Now k mu is even simpler because, again, the Lagrangian is a scalar field, so it transforms as a scalar field. So it transforms exactly like phi, except that S, in this case, is trivial, is the identity, because it's a scalar field. So it only transforms because the argument transforms. So, right? So the Lagrangian, it transforms into the Lagrangian lambda minus 1 of X, which is equal to the Lagrangian of X minus epsilon mu mu X mu d mu Lagrangian. Only this second part term here, not this, because sigma is 0. system here now looks a little bit weird, because it doesn't look manifestly a total derivative. The shift of the Lagrangian under this transformation epsilon is shifts into x d mu l. It doesn't look like a total derivative. There is x in front. However, this term here, it is still equal to d mu x mu l, a total derivative, because if you take the difference between this and this is d mu x mu times l. And d mu x nu is just the Kronecker delta d mu nu, delta mu nu. But delta mu nu, epsilon mu nu, it just extract the trace of epsilon. But remember, epsilon are the generator of Lorentz, and they are traceless. So you get zero. Analogously, if you lower one of the indices, you will find that epsilon mu nu is antisymmetric, d mu x nu will give you the metric, which is symmetric, and you get antisymmetrics times a symmetric tensor, which are zero. So, in fact, this expression is the same as this expression, so it's a total derivative. So let me rewrite, then this is equal to minus d mu epsilon mu mu x mu the Lagrangian density. Now I already used mu nu indices to label the indices of alphas. So I cannot use the same index for the current. So for this particular case, and let me call rho the label, the index associated to the current, and mu nu the index associated that will appear inside alpha here. Okay. So my current will have rho index and mu nu index. Mu nu are the sixth generator, and rho is the index of the current. So let me write k in terms of rho. So I want to write this as d rho epsilon rho. So I can do this with the mu index here and a Kronecker delta, like before, mu rho here. And all right, and then I extract epsilon mu nu as I did here and there. So epsilon mu nu I started with the lower indices. So let me lower this index here and raise this index here, which becomes g mu rho. So I can finally extract k rho mu nu which is what multiply epsilon mu nu and is inside the total derivative, so it's minus x g nu rho x nu the Lagrangian net. And in analogy to what we did, before I had also one half here, which I forgot, so this one half. And here also this mu nu are anti-symmetrized because they're saturated with the epsilon mu nu. So I can also anti-symmetrize them and rewrite this term as 1/2 x mu g mu rho minus x mu g mu rho Lagrangian density. You're almost there. So I'm taking a little bit more time today, but didn't want to interrupt the middle. But we're almost there, because now we have all the ingredients, delta phi and k, and we just have to replace it in the expression here, and get our six conserved currents. So we see that j rho mu nu is what? Dr in d rho phi r, which multiply delta phi, which is all this, so there is a 1/2 side, and there is a term which is sigma mu mu r s, sorry, s. I'm going to rewrite on the side of this, plus 1/2 dl in d rho phi r, times x mu d mu phi r minus x mu d mu phi r, and finally I have to subtract k rho, which is minus 1/2 the Lagrangian density times x mu g mu rho minus x mu g mu rho. Okay. Now this ugly expression simplifies a little bit. If you notice that what multiply x mu here is dl in d rho phi r d nu phi r minus g nu rho the Lagrangian density. But this whole combination is nothing else than T rho nu, the energy momentum tensor with indices rho nu. So dl d, d minus Lagrangian g. And similar means for what to multiply x nu here. So this object can also be written. First, let's multiply everything by 2. After all, if this is conserved, also 2 times this is conserved. So I remove all the 1/2. This object here, which is conserved, let me call it m rho mu nu, and is equal to dl in d rho phi r sigma mu nu rs phi s, the first term, and then this term is what? Plus x mu times, we said that this was T rho nu. minus x mu t rho mu. And that's it. So for each couple of mu nu antisymmetric indices, which are six combinations, there is a conserved current, m rho, such that v rho and rho mu nu is identically zero. So for each two m nu, there is a conserved current and a conserved charge. The charge, as usual, is the integral in d3x of the zero component, zero in rho, of this object here. And the current, typically called J mu nu, as therefore the integral in d3x of m0 mu nu. And if you write then explicitly, they will have the integral in d3x. Now, dl in d phi dot is just phi, as usual, the conjugate momentum phi r, sigma mu nu rs by s. And then here you extract the combination x mu t0 nu minus x mu t0 mu. So these are the six conserved charges that come out from Lorentz invariance. So what's the interpretation of these six conserved charges? Let's see them one by one, or three by three. Let's take the special component Gij of this object. So if I take only the special components, these are six conserved charges, which have the form of d3x, pi r, sigma ij, rs, pi s, plus xi, t0j, you remember t0j was the density of momentum, pj, minus xj, pi. And you can see here a very familiar expression, or this part of it is very familiar. We are looking at now the conserved charges associated to the special part of the Lorentz group, which are special rotations. So what are the charges that are conserved because of invariance and the special rotation? The total angular momentum, right? And in fact, here you see the expression for the total angular momentum for a generic field configuration. There are different parts. Here, you can recognize what is the analog in field theory of the orbital angular momentum. This is xi pj minus xj pi is nothing else than, right, the external derivative between x and p, which is L, the angular momentum, of course, for a continuum classical field. So what you do is that for each trivolume in space, you measure the local momentum, the local distance, you take the external product, and then you sum over all three volumes. And this will give you the total angular momentum of the field configuration. But the nice part of this expression is that it tells you that it's not just the angular momentum to be conserved, but there is an extra piece. This extra piece here has to do with the intrinsic way the field transforms under Lorentz. In particular, if you have a scalar field, this object is not there, the angular momentum is conserved, the orbital angular momentum. But in case the field has associated a non-trivial transformation property under Lorentz, for example, is a vector, then it means that for each point in space, there is some preferred direction in which the field points. And this vector associated to the intrinsic vector associated to the field in each point also contributes to this total angular momentum. And this intrinsic angular momentum of the field is called speed. And you see nicely that in classical field theory versus particle physics, what is conserved is just the sum of the spin and the angular momentum, not them independently. And this comes automatically from Lorentz invariance. Any questions? Sorry, can you speak loud, more loudly?
Are there accidental conservations? I mean, conservation that doesn't correspond to symmetry.
Are there any conservation laws that are not associated to a symmetry? I think not, but I don't know the proof. I have to think about it. Okay? All right. So, any other questions about this? Okay. So, these were the three conserved charges associated to the special part of this tensor, but we said we had six independent parameters in Lorentz symmetry, so we expect other three conserved quantities associated to the other three parameters, which are those associated to the boost. So what are the conserved quantities associated to Lorentz boost? And many of you might not have ever heard about the three charges associated to boost invariance, and there is a reason why you might not have heard of them. So what they are? Well, we just to extract here the zero I, for example, I zero component. So let me call this ki. These are the integral dpx of the zero I component of this. So here there is a piece which is pi r sigma zero I rs phi s. Then we have x naught, which is, let me call it more precisely, time. T0i, which is the special part of the t-momentum pi, minus xi, t00, which is the Hamiltonian density. Okay, so this object is conserved. So what? What it is? I don't know. Let me see in a simplified case what it is. Let's take now a scalar field. For a scalar field, sigma mu nu is equal to zero, right? Because it transforms trivially. So this part is zero. So the conservation of K just say that this object here is conserved. So what does it mean? Well, it means that if I perform the integral in d3t of this, I get t integral in d3x of pi, which is the special part of the three momentum pi, minus integral in d3x x I Hamiltonian density. All this is conserved, so it's a constant. Well, if this is a constant, I can divide by the total energy, the Hamiltonian, which is also a constant. So this object is still a constant. And now I can bring this object on the other side. What is this object? This object is the integral in space of the position weighted with the energy divided by the total energy. So this is the analogous of the center of mass. It's the average, where is located the average energy of the system, of the field configuration. So this equation tells me that the average position, the center of mass, or center of energy of the field, x, which is this object here, is equal to a constant plus the total momentum P over the total energy H times time. But you see, total momentum over total energy is just the velocity. So this equation just tells you that the center of energy moves with constant speed, which is just an inertial principle. The system is isolated since you already consider the whole space. There is no external force on it. So somehow it's a not very illuminating new quantity. And there is an extra reason why we will see also in quantum field theory these quantities are not so interesting. And they come from the fact that these conserved charges have an explicit time dependence. You see? There is time here. What does it mean? So if you write the equation of motion of these charges, so the derivative of this ki respect to time, the total derivative, can be written as the Poisson brackets of ki with the Hamiltonian plus the derivative of ki, the partial derivative with respect to time. So normally, if the conserved charge does not depend on time explicitly, this second term is zero. The time derivative is just fixed by the Poisson bracket. And when you quantize, Poisson brackets becomes commutator. And this implies that the commutator of the conserved charge with the Hamiltonian zero, which means that you can diagonalize the Hamiltonian and the charge at the same time, which means that you can actually use those charges to classify your Hilbert space, your eigenfunction of the energy. So you can choose a basis where both the charge and the Hamiltonian are diagonal. So you can classify states by energy and charge. But this requires that there is no explicit time dependence. If there is an explicit time dependence, like in this case, and k is a conserved charge, which means that the total derivative in time is zero, because it's a conserved charge, it means that if this is different from zero, it means that the commutator cannot be zero. Which means that you cannot use these charges to classify eigenstates of the Hamiltonian. Either you use the total energy or these charges here. So unlike the other charges that are conserved, that can be used to classify your Hilbert space in the quantum theory, so you can at the same time talk about a state with a determined energy, a determined three momentum, and a determined angular momentum or spin. This is not true for these charges here, so they're usually not considered. And with this, I finish a little bit over time this week, this lecture today. Any questions?